Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores.
Okay, hello everyone, and a warm welcome to ICA's virtual seminar series. Thank you for joining us as we continue to focus on the world and food security in Latin America and the Caribbean in the post-COVID-19 pandemic. My name is Beverly Best, and I am the Director of External and Institutional Relations at ICA headquarters in San Jose, Costa Rica. For this sixth seminar series, ICA is putting the spotlight on the Caribbean region, more specifically to focus on the post-COVID-19 scenario from the perspective of Caribbean countries. ICA could not have done a better job in its selection of panelists to address this topic. I have the pleasure of welcoming and introducing our panelists, Dr. Chelston Brathwaite and Dr. James Fletcher, both of whom are well-distinguished and exemplary nationals of the Caribbean, as well as consummate professionals in their respective disciplines and careers. Dr. Chelston Brathwaite. He is a Barbadian national who holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Agricultural Science, a Master's degree, as well as a PhD in Plant Pathology from Cornell University. Dr. Brathwaite has a Diploma in Agricultural Development with distinction from the University of London and has completed courses in Executive Management at La Escuela de Negocios Internacionales and in Leadership for senior executives at Harvard Business School. He was also a lecturer in the Faculty of Agriculture of the University of the West Indies. Between 2001 and 2010, Dr. Brathwaite served as the Director General of ICA and is the first and remains the only Caribbean national to have served in this capacity. Since his retirement from ICA, he served as the interim director of the Faculty of Food and Agriculture at UWI St. Augustine campus, and also as the ambassador of Barbados to the People's Republic of China. Dr. James Fletcher, affectionately known as Jimmy to me, he is a St. Lucia national who holds a Bachelor of Science degree in biochemistry from the University of Ottawa, Canada, and a Doctor of Philosophy degree in crop physiology from the University of Cambridge. He's a former Minister of Public Service, Sustainable Development, Energy, Science and Technology in St. Lucia between 2011 and 2016. Dr. Fletcher is perhaps best known or most known for his work in international climate change negotiations. When in 2015, he led the Caribbean's delegation to the negotiations on the Paris Agreement, and was part of the small select group of ministers who were responsible for achieving consensus among the parties to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. Prior to this, Dr. Fletcher served as the Director of Sustainable and Social Development Division at the Secretariat of the Organization of Eastern Caribbean States, and as the Cabinet Secretary in the Government of St. Lucia, and the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Agriculture, Forestry, and Fisheries. Currently, he manages his own consulting company, Solaricon, which provides services in the areas of sustainable energy, climate change, water policy, information and communications technology, agriculture, and public policy development. It is a real pleasure for me to welcome everyone to join this virtual seminar, where we will engage in some thought-provoking conversation on our topic. But before we proceed, ICA would like to acknowledge and thank all frontline workers, first responders, as well as our farmers and other persons in the food supply chain in the Caribbean, who are not only working tirelessly to keep us safe as the world continues to fight this pandemic, but are also keeping us healthy and ensuring there is food on our tables. We owe you a true debt of gratitude for the sacrifices you are making. This pandemic provides bold testimony to the vulnerability of the Caribbean as the region faces an unprecedented socio-economic shock from the sudden collapse of its main export service, tourism, and export commodity, oil. Now, layered on top of this scenario is the fact that the Caribbean region is defined as the most vulnerable region on the planet in terms of shocks related to disasters and climate change. With a recent history of three Category 5 hurricanes in 2 years, during 2017 and 2019, and the compound risk of a projected fierce hurricane season for 2020, the time is ripe to build on the conversation of vulnerability towards perspectives that will speak to the need for transformational changes that will give rise to building resilience and ensuring sustainability in the region post-COVID-19. Without further ado, I would first invite you, Dr. Braffy, to share your views on our topic, the post-COVID-19 scenario from the perspective of Caribbean countries. Dr. Braffy.
Let me begin by saying how pleased I am and honored I am to be part of this distinguished panel this morning and to have been invited by ICA to participate in this noble endeavor, which I see as a very unique opportunity for the Institute to demonstrate its commitment to serving the needs of the member states, not only in normal times, but in times of crisis. And I believe without a doubt that we are on the cusp of a new development in our world and in our hemisphere and in the Caribbean. And I'm indeed pleased to be part of this opportunity to present my views on what I see is an opportunity. I start off by saying that to a large extent, I learned something when I lived in China. That is that the word crisis has two components. One component is danger. The second component is opportunity. And I think in this particular situation, what we should be looking for, we have already in the danger zone, but what we have to look forward to is what is the opportunity, or what are the opportunities that can arise from this particular situation. The COVID-19 pandemic continues to cause considerable human and economic loss and concern throughout the world. The continued spread in the Caribbean has created an unstable social and economic situation. The World Bank, the IMF, the ECLAC, the IDB, the Caribbean Development Bank, and several Caribbean economists have all indicated that the pandemic will have a significant negative impact on economic growth and social stability in the Caribbean region now and in the future. In fact, the IMF predicts that the sudden stop in tourism and the decline in oil prices are sharply slowing economic activity in the region, and growth is expected to contract in 2020 by 6.2%. Many local economists think that the estimate by the IMF is rather generous, and they anticipate a contraction that will be much deeper and much more severe. In fact, one leading economist in the Caribbean believes we shall have a contraction of about 15% in 2020. This therefore represents a significant challenge for Caribbean economies, and we are at a stage where we must find ways to resolve and to emerge stronger and more organized to face the challenges of this 21st century.
Thank you, Dr. Braffitt. Thank you very much for those, I would say, thought-provoking interventions and giving an overview of the magnitude of what it is the Caribbean region will be facing. You spoke about perhaps the potential contraction in the economy, And I would dare to say that this calls for us to really think long and hard as to how we're going to use the opportunity that is before us to ensure that we do come out stronger, we build back better. Without any further comments on my side, I will call my friend Dr. James Fletcher, better known as Jimmy, to give his first intervention on this particular topic. Jimmy, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Beverly, and good day, everyone. And thank you, most importantly, to AICA for inviting me to participate in this virtual seminar on food security in Latin America and the Caribbean post-COVID-19. I think it's very safe for us to say that COVID-19 has brought the Caribbean and Latin America to a very important point in the history, a very important inflection point in the history of our development. This crisis has exposed the vulnerabilities in our societies. It has shown us the fragility of our economic development agenda, which for us in the Caribbean depends very heavily on tourism. For 10 of our Caribbean nations, tourism contributes over 25% to our national GDP. And in each of these 10 islands, its contribution to employment ranges from a low of 30% to a high of over 80%. Unfortunately, tourism is the sector perhaps that is hardest hit by this COVID-19 pandemic, and it may be one of the slowest to recover. This is having already a negative impact on government revenues, on employment, and on household incomes. The conservative estimates, as you heard from Dr. Brathwaite, are that economic activity will decline by over 6% across our region. And like Dr. Brathwaite, I would be very surprised if this figure is not significantly higher. Another area that we will see a significant impact will be in remittances. A recent report indicated that the Caribbean receives on an annual basis $15.8 billion every year in remittances, the bulk of which admittedly goes to the Dominican Republic, Haiti, and Jamaica. But every single one of our islands depends very heavily on remittances. And these remittances come from three important sources: the United Kingdom, the United States of America, and Canada. And they are very important non-state social protection mechanisms, because it's often the poorest and the most vulnerable households that are the recipients of these remittances. If, as we've seen, the job losses that have taken place in the US, I mean, last month, the US lost over 20 million jobs. Canada lost 2 million jobs last month. Unemployment went up to 13% in Canada, 14.7% in the USA. In the UK, it's predicted that unemployment will reach 10% in this quarter. So if, as the World Bank is predicting, remittances drop by almost 20% as a result of COVID-19, this will have a dramatic impact on household incomes, particularly among our poorest and most vulnerable populations, who are the ones who are suffering the most as a result of this COVID-19 crisis. So really, I think, as again, echoing what Dr. Brathwaite has said, this COVID-19 crisis gives us an opportunity. We are in the middle of a war right now, a war with a virus, but there is an opportunity for us to do things differently. An opportunity for us to do things differently with respect to our major industry, which is tourism. We have to change how we address tourism going forward. You know, tourism is natural for the Caribbean. We have all of the attributes. We have breathtaking natural beauty, warm, sunny weather year-round, good international travel links, excellent cuisine, beautiful white sand beaches, great music, hospitable people. So, you know, it almost looks like we were tailor-made for tourism. And I think, unfortunately, that has caused us to take the easy route where the tourism industry is concerned. And we have to change that going forward. We must make our industry much more sustainable. We must ensure that it creates greater social equity. But most importantly for me, we have to ensure that the links between tourism and agriculture are better. And that takes me to the critical question of food security. This, I think, is what has been exposed most by this COVID-19 crisis, the food insecurity of our region. Our reliance on imported foods, primarily from the USA, has caused great anxiety among our local populations about our ability to feed ourselves during this crisis. You know, the food import bill for the CARICOM member states increased from $2.08 billion in 2000 to $4.75 billion US in 2018. So in less than two decades, we've more than doubled our food import bill. And in my estimation, the worst of this COVID crisis with respect to food security is yet to come. We have not yet seen the impact of the closures of some of these farms and food processing plants in the USA that took place during the mandatory shelter-in-place curfews in the various states in the US. We have not yet seen the impact that that will have on supply chains and on the ability of our countries to be able to access that imported food that we normally look for. So I think the greatest opportunity for us is for us to recalibrate our approach to food security in our region. Agriculture has declined steadily over the last two decades in every single one of our countries. In my country, St. Lucia, agriculture contributed 15.7% to GDP in 1990. Today, it's a paltry 1.7%. Now, for a country that has an abundance of natural resources, that has all of the attributes that you would think would make agriculture a mainstay of its economy, that's unconscionable. So we really must revive our agricultural sector because it gives us an opportunity to do many things. One, cut back on our leakage of foreign exchange for our high food import bill, rejuvenate our rural economies, which depend so much on agriculture, stimulate new employment in food production enterprises, and improve our nutrition profiles by replacing processed imported foods with more wholesome and nutritious local foods. But for this to happen, there are many changes that must take place. We have to have a better land use policy because too many of our arable lands are being lost to commercial and residential developments. We need proper market intelligence for our farmers so that they can schedule their production according to demand. I think, you know, we focus a lot on export agriculture, but we have a large unfulfilled demand within the tourism industry. That is where we should be looking first and see how we can cause that linkage that we've been speaking about for years and decades now to finally happen. We have to address the problem of our farmers accessing affordable finance and how do we mitigate the risk that is causing the banks to not want to extend credit to our farmers. That is something that has to be looked at. We have to modernize our agricultural sector through the use of appropriate technology and especially in renewable energy. One of the reasons that nobody except Trinidad and Tobago and maybe to a lesser extent Jamaica has a value-added sector is because the cost of energy is too high. But in the Caribbean, we have an abundance of solar, abundance of sun, an abundance of wind. We should be using that to drive our cost of energy down so that we can cause that rejuvenation in our food processing, our value-added sector to finally take place. And then for me, because of my close connection with what's happening with climate change and climate change adaptation, we have to better manage the use of water in crop production, particularly given that as our planet gets warmer, our hydrological cycles will become more unpredictable, more variable, and because we depend so much on rain-fed agriculture, it will be one of the serious constraints to causing that food security, that food sovereignty that we're pushing. So we have to make much better use of water in crop production and agriculture. Better water capture, better water storage, better water reuse and rainwater harvesting. Those are all things that we have to look at. So I think, Beverly, for me, that's a large summary of where we are right now. There are other opportunities that we can probably talk about a little bit later on in this discussion, but that is where I see COVID in the Caribbean. Yes, a crisis, but even more importantly, an opportunity to recalibrate our development and to finally help us to build in that resilience in all the sectors that is so important if we are to look at the Caribbean playing the role that it needs to play, one, for the development of its people and the protection of their livelihoods, but secondly, the very important role that the Caribbean plays in the global economy.
Thank you, James. This was quite a bit on your side, and thank you very much for that intervention. Now, the summary of what you have said in terms of the need for ensuring food security provides a suitable segue into what I would really want us to delve into a little bit more, and perhaps to call Dr. Braffy to respond to this, because you said you learned two things about a crisis while you were in China, that it's both something negative, a challenge, a sort of a problem, but the opportunity. Now, we all agree that this crisis will end. We don't know when, but it will end. But the cause for agriculture and food security in the Caribbean, as Jimmy has just said, will remain. He spoke about the statistics in terms of our food import bill, which is about, he said, projected at $4 to $6 billion US dollars. But a recent figure says for 2020, we are looking at a food import bill of about $8 to $10 billion US dollars. And perhaps that is conservative. So my question to you, Dr. Braffy, is what do you consider? I mean, Jimmy has touched on some of those, and perhaps you can choose one or two whereby you wish to delve into some more details. What do you consider to be some of the key issues the Caribbean region should focus on to confront this systemic issue of a lack of food security in the region?
Thank you for that opportunity and thank you for the wonderful question. Let me congratulate Dr. Fletcher on covering a significant aspect of the reality of the Caribbean today. He has touched on the sensitivity to climate change, our vulnerabilities in that respect. He has touched on the food security issue. I would like to say that in a real sense, this crisis exposes five of the critical vulnerabilities of Caribbean countries. The first vulnerability is vulnerability to climate change. And Dr. Fletcher dealt in great detail and with great passion on that particular topic. The fact that we are so susceptible to extreme weather events is a reality of our geographic position in the world. The second reality is that it exposes our vulnerability to levels of debt. The Caribbean countries are some of the most indebted countries in the world. Small economies, but in serious debt situation. I remember in 2018, Barbados' situation was something like 174% of GDP. The debt profile was 174% of GDP. At that time, it was said to be one of the third largest indebted country in the world. So we are an indebted region. The third one is the high levels of chronic non-communicable diseases. High levels of obesity, of diabetes, of hypertension, and cancer. The other one has to do with our high dependence on the tourism sector. Dr. Fletcher implicated that. The reality that we have become very dependent on tourism as a source of growth and development. And the last one is our food insecurity. Now, as we look to the future then, to me, it is the opportunity to revise our development model. Our development model is the following. The majority of the countries of the Caribbean grew by narrowly focusing on tourism and entered into a dependency on imports for almost all their daily requirements, food, medicine, machinery, technology, etc. We have become a dependent nation or a collection of dependent nations in the context of critical inputs for our development. We have moved in a manner which allows us to collect money from tourism and use those resources to buy the things that we need, including food. But that's a perverse model because as you get tourists coming to your country, you receive income from the tourists, and then you use that income to buy the food that you feed to the same tourists. That model is not sustainable. And this is what we have done over the years. We have used tourism income to buy food to feed the same tourists that come to our shores so that we get less and less of the tourist dollar remaining in our countries for development. So we are actually exporting our wealth. We obtain the wealth from our tourist resources, the beauty of the Caribbean, the lovely beaches, the ambiance, and then we take that money that we receive from tourism and send it abroad to buy commodities such as food, which we should be producing. And so one of the weaknesses of the development model that we have in most of the countries of the Caribbean is this high dependence on imports and particularly food. Let me just say that this is not something that is comforting. The global threat of hunger, the lack of work, the possibility of a food crisis now exposes all of us to this vulnerability in stark reality. And more, countries are beginning to review their development agenda and are placing food security as a priority item for consideration. But placing food security on the development agenda is not sufficient. There must be concrete actions taken so that this is not a flash in the pan, but a sustainable endeavor that will ensure that we never go back to that development model that makes us so dependent and so vulnerable. So what is necessary? What is necessary is a new appreciation and an understanding of the contribution that the agricultural sector can make to development. In most of the countries, agriculture in today's world is contributing just about 2% to GDP. Dr. Fletcher mentioned the case of St. Lucia, where in the past agriculture was the mainstay of the economy. Today it is less than 2%. In my country, Barbados, it is also less than 2%. And because it is less than 2%, we do not provide financial resources to the agricultural sector. In fact, in most of the budgets of the countries of the Caribbean, agriculture is low priority. Because it is underfinanced and because it is not recognized as being able to provide strategic development resources and initiatives, in our terms, we have neglected the sector. What will it take to bring it back? A reformulation, a repositioning, a re-understanding of the backward and forward linkages that agriculture can provide. It is not about production. It's also about processing. It's also about packaging. It's also about transport. It's also about labeling. It's all of these generate jobs in the commodity chain as you develop agriculture. And it's not about agriculture at the national level, it's also about agriculture at the regional level. We need to see food security in a regional context. Most of our countries are small, limited land space, but there are countries in the region with enormous land spaces: Guyana, Belize, Suriname. That should be the food baskets of the Caribbean, not that each individual country cannot produce, yes. But there's certain commodities that require space and scale. For example, we produce 400,000 tons of wheat every year into the Caribbean. We could replace a significant amount of that wheat by growing cassava, by growing root crops and processing them here. And if we were to do that, we could reduce our food import bill by 5% overnight. But we also have to put in place the structures and the governance and the strategies that will make that possible. And making that possible implies we must understand agriculture differently. We must understand that agriculture is not about production only. It's also about value added. It's about processing. It's about making sure that we produce the products that the consumer need in a form that is convenient to the consumer. We've had in our countries over the last 25 years a supermarket revolution. In the old days, the householders went to the corner shop or to the farmer's market to get their food. Today they go to the supermarket. And going to the supermarket implies a different level of expectation in terms of presentation, price, quality, reliability, etc. We have to move up the development ladder in our agricultural sector and begin to produce products that are of the quality and the price and the consistency and the reliability that a consumer expects. And therefore, that implies training the farmers, investing in technology, creating the linkages between agriculture and tourism. Dr. Fletcher mentioned that. That has been one of our weaknesses. Instead of linking agriculture to tourism, we believe that tourists come from over and away to eat the food that they were eating over and away. That's totally absurd. They come to the Caribbean to experience the Caribbean reality. And the Caribbean reality implies the Caribbean food. The roti, the ackee and salt fish, the cuckoo and flying fish, the various fare that we can offer the tourists, and that translates into income for our farmers. So we have not developed those linkages sufficiently, and consequently, we export our wealth by sending money out to buy food to feed the tourists that come to our shores. And so the model has to change. We have to have a new thinking, a new understanding of our reality. And one of the things that is critical is the role of the Minister of Agriculture. In the traditional sense, we often had the Minister of Agriculture as a Minister of Production, a Minister of Farmers, a Minister of the Field. But today's world said the Minister of Agriculture has to be a Minister of Production and a Minister of Consumption. His responsibility is for the food of the nation, not just its production, but its utilization, its sustainability, the quality, the stability. All of that is now the new context of a Minister of Agriculture. Therefore, the focus of the ministries of agriculture has to change. They must now become ministries of food security, ministries of food and nutrition security that ensures the food supply, the quality of the food, its stability, its reliability, and its price for the consumer. At the same time, supporting the production process. So we need for some new structures and understandings of the agricultural sector to make it what it should be. The true contribution of agriculture to development has to be understood in the Caribbean. And William Demas, one of our outstanding economists, who was the governor of the Caribbean Development Bank at one time and head of the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago, said it years ago, those backward and forward linkages in the commodity chain between production, processing, agro-industry, industry, marketing, all of that has to be brought together to make sure that the agricultural sector play its key role in the development of our economies.
Thank you very much, Dr. Braffith. I'm really pleased with what I'm hearing so far, and I'm happy that we have the opportunity to spread this information far and wide and trust that it will not only just be brought to the listening ear of the key decision makers, but it will really set the tone for changing the mindset, changing paradigms in terms of our thinking towards agricultural development in the Caribbean. Now, you touched on the last point you made about the role of the Minister of Agriculture. It really provides me with a good entry point to speak to a previous Minister of Agriculture, Dr. Fletcher, to hear his take, who I can tell you was really not a Minister of Consumption and of Production, because I know Jimmy did quite a bit in his time. I would just ask him to touch a little bit on perhaps an issue that both you and Dr. Braffith mentioned, the whole question about the financial stability, the indebtedness, I suppose the whole geopolitical forces of the financial services in our region, as well as perhaps as we talk about changing the strategies, the structures, etc. What role do we see for perhaps public-private partnerships or a new model, as Dr. Braffith has said, that incorporates perhaps different players to really transform the agricultural sector in the Caribbean? Dr. Fletcher.
Thanks, Beverly. Just one correction. I was a minister of a lot of things: public service, information broadcasting, sustainable development, energy, science and technology, but I was never a minister of agriculture. I was a permanent secretary of agriculture.
That's true. You're correct. You're correct on that one.
But what Dr. Braffith said is absolutely correct. And I'll go one step further and say that not only do you need a new philosophy, a new mindset, and a new person for your traditional Minister of Agriculture, because I think very often when the Prime Minister chooses his or her cabinet, he or she fills other positions before he or she fills the position of Minister of Agriculture. There are other portfolios that are deemed to be more important. If the Prime Minister doesn't take finance, then finance is probably the first on the pecking order. Then you have the Minister of Education, and you have the Minister of Health, and you have the Minister of National Security. Those are considered the more important, and also your Minister of Foreign Affairs, those are considered the more important ministries in our Caribbean context before you get to the Minister of Agriculture. So what Dr. Braffith said is absolutely correct. But I'll take it one step further and say you need a different mindset of our prime ministers and our leaders, because I think that's where some of the problem lies. I do not believe that our prime ministers understand. There are one or two exceptions, so I'm not painting everybody with that brush. And for, because I do not want to be attacked by any one prime minister, I leave it blank and say there are one or two exceptions, notable exceptions. But there, in general, we do not see that level of appreciation of the importance of agriculture. And as Dr. Braffitt said, the importance of food security. And I think that change in nomenclature is important because it will cause the ministry and the minister to think differently. Your role is not just to provide support to the farmer and to aid agriculture. Your role is food security, or now as we speak about food sovereignty, that you have greater control over your food supply and you're not beholden to food imports to feed your people. So I am 100% with Dr. Braffitt on that one. And as I said, I go even further and say that our prime ministers need to change their approach towards agriculture, because it is under their watch that agriculture's contribution has diminished from the mid-teens to less than 2%. And that should be saying something. Now, the point you raise about debt, both you and Dr. Braffitt raise about debt, is a very important one. Most of our countries have limited fiscal space within which they can operate. So with a debt to GDP ratio of 60%, 70%, 80%, or in some of our islands over 100%, it means that you don't have the fiscal space that you need to make the sorts of interventions in agriculture, but also in health and education that you would like. And unfortunately, climate change is worsening the situation, because all of our countries always find themselves in this constant cycle of repair and recovery. No sooner than you recover from one storm, then you have to now deal with another storm. And it doesn't have to be a full-fledged hurricane. It could be a drought, as we've had this year, a very debilitating drought. Our farmers are reeling in St. Lucia this year as a result of this drought that we've had. Farmers have had to abandon their farms. That has had a serious impact on agriculture. You know, flooding, seasonal and sometimes unseasonal flooding that you've had. So, and every time you have one of these events, the governments have to borrow money for them to engage in recovery, engage in repair. So that has reduced the fiscal space that we have. So this issue of debt has to be dealt with. I know some of our countries, with the assistance of organizations like ECLAC, are looking at debt for climate swaps, debt for environment swaps. I think that's very important. How do we cause a third party to come in and buy up some of that debt and give the countries the space that the money that it would have used on debt servicing can now be used for environment or climate change adaptation activities? But I think that should also come with a caveat that clearing up that debt and the resultant improvement in the health of the balance sheet of the country should not be a signal for it to go and now borrow more money. And I think there really has to be a different way in which we deal with. Parliament must put in place measures to prevent this kind of reckless borrowing that we've seen in too many of our islands, because we seem to have this preoccupation of big infrastructure projects. I know it looks good at the end of 5 years when you're presenting yourself to the electorate and you say, boy, look at all the things that I've done. It's much easier to say that I've put up three new buildings than to say that I've improved food security or I've reduced poverty. Those are not things that are easily measurable, unfortunately, but those are the things that we should be focusing on. So I think that's why I call for a different approach. And consistent with what Dr. Braffitt said, there must be a change in our development agenda. Going back to something that he pointed out with tourism and the absurdity, as he pointed out, of us using the tourism dollar to feed the tourists. But there's an even bigger absurdity. For most of these hotels to establish, we gave them income tax and duty concessions. So we are foregoing revenue. So the money that we should be collecting, and as we're collecting in taxes from hard-paying, hard-working taxpayers like you and me, the hotel owners are not paying those taxes, because the incentive we gave to them to establish was tax holidays, and they can bring in all of their supplies duty-free. So we are not collecting money, we're foregoing revenue. And then the little revenue that we're collecting, we're using it to feed the tourists. So I've always said that we should make our incentive regime contingent on the hotel purchasing local. So I will give you a base level of incentives that establishing would allow you to establish in my country. And for every quantum of local produce, it could be agricultural produce, it could be furniture that you purchase, then I will give you more concessions, because I know the concessions I'm giving to you, you are putting it back into my economy. But I can't give you concessions. I can't forego revenue for you to now export that revenue, and for me also to export that revenue feeding you. That doesn't make sense. So again, that's why this change in paradigm has to take place. Dr. Braffitt spoke very clearly about the need for us to, in reviving our economies, we have to look at inter-regional trade. We have countries that have a comparative advantage in production. Antigua and Barbados will never be able to produce food at the volumes that is required to feed their tourism industries, which is very big. The tourism industry is very big in both Antigua and Barbados because they don't have the landmass and because of the density of their population. But there are other countries in the Caribbean that can do that. So why, instead of looking to North America for produce, we're not looking to Ghana, we're not looking to Belize, we're not looking to Suriname, we're not looking to Grenada, we're not looking to St. Lucia to supply some of that food so that we can, in redeveloping and re-energizing our economies, we start looking internally, because the tourists that we're looking for, it'll be a while before they start coming back. It'll be a while before we see tourism getting back to its level. So South-South cooperation within the Caribbean, but also South-South cooperation between the Caribbean and Latin America, I think is extremely important, because we have to look to each other. There are complementarities in the things that we produce and the things that we need. And that is how I think we will develop resilience, by banding together and not by each island functioning as an island and going out boldly and saying, you know, every time I hear Prime Minister compare the development in his or her country to another OECS or Caribbean country, I cringe, because we should not be competing with each other. We should be competing with Singapore and South Korea and Taiwan. I shouldn't be saying that St. Lucia grew by 3.2% as compared to Barbados, which only grew by 1.5%. No, St. Lucia's problem is Barbados's problem. I need to say that St. Lucia grew by 4.5%, and that was consistent with a Caribbean average of 4.7%, and was much better than the growth in Taiwan and Singapore and South Korea, because that's who we should be competing with. So I think we have to change the focus of our development. We have to cooperate more with each other. But we also have to understand, Beverly, that there are some opportunities, I think, that are presenting themselves. And again, COVID is pointing this out. There's now an increased focus on health. The people who are most victimized by COVID are the elderly. And of course, the elderly have no control over this. If you pass a certain age, yes, you are more vulnerable. But the people who are also victimized by COVID are those with underlying conditions. And as Dr. Braffitt clearly pointed out, chronic non-communicable diseases, that is one of the very serious threats facing our region. But these are lifestyle diseases. These are lifestyle diseases caused by poor eating habits, sedentary lifestyles, but they can now be addressed by causing people to eat more wholesome foods. When I saw what was going on in St. Lucia, where immediately we went into lockdown, the government gave care packages, food packages to vulnerable people. But those care packages had cans of corned beef and rice and tuna fish and carnation milk. I'm saying, no, that's not how you build immunity. You might be dealing with a hole in somebody's stomach, but really what should be in those care packages should be green banana, should be breadfruit, should be fruits and vegetables, so that one, you are providing a market for your farmers, but secondly, you're helping to build immunity. So I think that focus on health gives us an opportunity to rejuvenate our agricultural sector, but also to take it in areas that normally we would not have gone. If you go into Holland and Barrett in the UK, or Whole Foods in the US, you will see a range of products, nutraceutical products, that are made from the things that have always been part of the natural pharmacopoeia in our Caribbean. So things like turmeric, that our grandparents always gave us as an anti-inflammatory. We didn't know that's what it was. They probably didn't know what it was, but they knew it addressed the problem. Ginger, anytime you had a stomach ailment, you were asked to drink ginger tea. That now, ginger is one of the biggest anti-inflammatory agents that you could buy on the shelves of Holland and Barrett and Whole Foods. Soursop is now seen as a major anti-carcinogen, but we all grew up on soursop leaf tea. So, you know, there are opportunities that I think that we need to tap into. And that's an area that our universities and our research institutions should get into. When I hear Madagascar touting its COVID remedy, I'm saying, but how do we know that there isn't some plant growing in a backyard in Barbados or in a backyard in Grenada or in St. Lucia that can help us maybe not develop immunity to COVID, but deal with some of the symptoms of COVID? But we're not doing that. So research and development is not part of our our focus in the region. And I think that is where we need to, as we fashion this new Caribbean that Dr. Braffitt has spoken so eloquently of, we have to start looking into other areas. We have to see how we can take advantage of this abundance of resources that we have in our region, both natural and human, because you have the Chelston Braffitts and the others who are as good as, if not better, than anybody produced in any institution in any North America or European university. We have those resources in our region. Why are we not using them? And why are we not saying to them, you now go out and help us to fashion? It's not just economists that will fashion the new Caribbean. It is scientists. It is both natural and social scientists who will help to fashion this new Caribbean. So we have to make greater use of our resources. And that is something that I feel very passionately about. And that is why I'm saying it calls for a whole new mindset in our leaders, because I don't know that our leaders are looking in that direction. And that for me is the biggest missed opportunity right now.
Okay, James, Jimmy, the systemic issues that you have outlined, as well as Dr. Braffitt, I mean, the word that seems to be a repeated constant is the question of opportunity. And it is indeed, I mean, it may sound a little bit strange to say opportunity given the pain people are experiencing now, but the reality is, despite that which is happening, we do have an ideal, and I would probably say unique opportunity to really get this right. It's unfortunate that it's a crisis that has caused us to think this way, or to perhaps be able to really try to push that reset button. What has been stated so far, I cannot agree more with, but there are two, I mean, very dear issues to my heart, and it would be remiss if I don't ask both of you to touch on it, even if it's for a brief moment. The whole question of youth, or Caribbean youth, and their involvement in agriculture to really reshape and to be part of that redefined framework we're talking about, as well as the question of the regionalism that exists, the need for strengthened regional integration. Dr. Braffitt touched on it, and I think Dr. Fletcher as well, the whole question of looking at our agricultural sector or looking at the region with regional lens. I mean, that has been what has been put forward, apart from just looking at the national response, but the regional approach that we need to take. So I want you two to touch on these before I try to wrap up, because I really think we need to at least give some sort of elucidate these two areas before we close the session today. Thank you.
Let me, Beverly, try to put on the table a nexus that I think you'll find interesting. We in the Caribbean, in spite of the CSME, which has been on the table for almost 20 years, Caribbean Common Market and Economy, in my view, have not advanced in strengthening the regional integration process as it relates to food and food security. We still have a problem moving food from one part of the Caribbean to the other. Transportation problem. We believe that there's need for regional transportation systems. Excuse me. That will facilitate the movement of food in the Caribbean. But in order to do that, you need information. You need a regional information system that would tell you what is being produced where, who has what, and at what price. That regional information system, given the interests of the youth in information today, they could be critical and important in helping us to set up a regional information system that would tell us what is available in Belize, what is available in Guyana, what does Barbados have, what is available in Jamaica, what are the products that we can move and at what price? But you have to have the logistics. The logistics have to go into place. You have to have the political will to put the logistics in place. We have been talking about this since 1975, when Eric Williams was the Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, and he had a conference at Chagaramas to talk about oil and food. 1975, we spoke about a regional food plan. 45 years later, it has not happened. And really, it is part of what we have to do, because food security, in my view, should be a priority for the Caribbean countries coming out of COVID. Food security should be a national priority. Just as national security is a national priority, national food security should also be a priority. Look, there are countries around the world, and I just give you one. Every year, one of the most important pieces of legislation that has to be passed in the Congress of a certain country is the Farm Bill. The Farm Bill is one of the most important pieces of legislation, because the Farm Bill is about feeding the nation. And if you do not feed the nation, or if you cannot feed the nation, you are susceptible to all kinds of influences. If the nation is not fed, you could have riots. People must have food. Just recently, when this COVID started, you see how many people are rushing to the supermarkets to get food and to buy toilet paper and buy all the supplies because they're worried about the future. The feeding of the nation is as critical as national security, and we must give it the priority that it deserves. The young people are ready. They are being trained, but they're not being given the opportunities because we have not defined the agricultural sector as a growth sector. And we have to put money in it. So my last point on this thing is two things. One, we have to put agricultural insurance in place to make sure that when we have a hurricane, and when we have an extreme weather event, that the farmers can be protected for their crops so that they can remain in business. So you need agricultural insurance. And the second thing you need, in my opinion, is a regional food security fund. We hear today about the Green Climate Fund, which supports initiatives in climate change and challenges that we may have with climate, which allows small countries to participate in the global agenda on climate change. What about a regional food security fund provided for by the World Bank and the IMF and the IDB and all these institutions that are around the place? They're giving support for fiscal deficits. They're giving support for a lot of things. What about food security? Who is saying, let us have a fund for food security? That is what we need. And that fund for food security would have elements: transportation, technology, information, strengthening youth groups, strengthening the NGOs, et cetera, a diverse set of initiatives in a fund, maybe managed by the Caribbean Development Bank. But this is something that if I had the opportunity to speak with the leaders of the region, I would say, let us establish a fund for food security in our region that responds to our reality, especially the non-communicable diseases that we have, the unemployment that we have, the fact that we are sending out our money outside to bring food for the tourists. Let us have a food security fund that responds to our reality. Because the vulnerability of which my Prime Minister, the Honorable Mia Moore-Motley, speaks is real. We are very vulnerable, and as small economies, we are too vulnerable, and we should not risk our food security as one of our vulnerabilities. We can't control all the climate issues. We can't control a lot of things, but we can do something about our food supply.
Thank you, Dr. Buffett. Jimmy, I would wish that you touch on these two issues, as I said earlier on, the whole question of youth, as well as the whole question of the regional approach towards food security. Thank you.
The interesting thing, Beverly, is that I think there's a misunderstanding. People actually believe the youth are not interested in agriculture, and that's not the case. I've seen in St. Lucia that there's a very serious and sustained interest of young people in agriculture. I have this program that I've been hosting on television in St. Lucia, a weekly program, and we've tried to focus a lot on young people. And one program we did was really looking at youth in agriculture. And I was surprised, you know, to hear that we had, there were three people we interviewed really in this 1 hour program. One is a doctor. The other one was a lawyer. Third was an accountant who had left their respective professions. And these are all young people under the age of 30, had left their respective professions and were now engaging full-time in agriculture. Fortunately for them, in each instance, their respective fathers owned farms. So they were managing their parents' farms. But for them, that was much more rewarding and much more in line with what they saw as being their contribution to society. And one of them is a doctor. And she told me that she felt running this farm for her father was giving her much more satisfaction than practicing medicine. And there are many people, I'm doing some work with an NGO here in St. Lucia, and we have so many young people who want access to land for them to engage in agriculture, want to do hydroponics, want to do mixed farming, who want someone to do vegetables, to serve as a tourism industry, someone to do mushroom production. So that how they view agriculture may be different to how the average farmer in the 1970s and 80s viewed agriculture, but they are still very keen on agriculture. And Dr. Braffitt touched on a very interesting point. The point really is, how do we match the demand with the supply? And how do we get that market intelligence out there so that we can get people producing for a market that exists, and not just a market that exists in the respective countries, but a market that exists within the region? And that's where this question of inter-regional transportation comes in. I do not understand how so many years later, as Dr. Braffitt pointed out, we are still talking about this and we haven't taken steps to address it. There must be, and I'm certain that there is, significant private sector interest, both philanthropy and loan funding, that would be interested if a good case can be made, and a good case can be made given the complexity and the growth in our respective tourism sectors, for us to look at expanding the agricultural sector. So there's a big demand. I like what, I hadn't thought of what Dr. Braffitt had said, the getting youth involved in the technology that would underpin the agricultural sector. I think that's a brilliant suggestion. And it's one that naturally young people would gravitate towards. That young people are developing apps and creating solutions on a daily basis. And I think that is a very good opportunity for them. So I like that. The question of regionalism, well, we had a conversation off camera about my views on our regional institutions. I think our regional institutions really need to step up. There are opportunities there for them that they are not taking advantage of. There are opportunities, first of all, for them to work together. I think too many of our regional institutions, maybe in this quest to remain financially viable, are too busy trying to get those project proposals out so that they could get funding from the development partners and the IFIs, the international financial institutions. But there are opportunities for collaboration, because I was just, when Dr. Braffitt was talking about a regional food security program, it brought me back to something that I suggested in an article I wrote in St. Lucia in the immediate, when our lockdown started, that one of the things we have to look at is a kind of post-COVID SDG fund for small island developing states, because all of these sustainable development goals have now been taken way off target for us. With the way we now have to respond to COVID, we are now set back years in achieving some of the targets under these 17 sustainable development goals. So when Dr. Braffitt speaks about a regional food security fund, you're talking about SDG 1, which speaks to poverty. You're talking about SDG 2, which speaks to zero hunger. SDG 3, good health and well-being, given the link between food and nutrition. SDG 14, life below water, that's our fishery sector. SDG 15, life on land, the agricultural sector. Responsible consumption and production, SDG 12. They're almost every single sustainable development goal would be impacted by a fund and a program that looks at how do we develop greater food security in our region. So I am 100% on board with that. But I think even more than that, our regional institutions need to refocus. they need to look at working together. There's too much dissipation of very scarce resources among four or five or six institutions, all of them trying to get relevance and to show how they can account for the funding that they're receiving from development partners better. And this goes back to this thing I spoke about earlier, where countries are now pitting themselves against each other. You have regional institutions pitting themselves against each other to continue to show relevance to development partners. We need to work together as a region, and we are not working together as a region. So the shortest answer to your question on regionalism is that I do not see any other time in our post-independence era when regionalism and regional integration has been more important, has been more relevant. That is the only way we will get through this. But it has to take a different approach. It has to take us doing less of what we do very much, very well in the Caribbean. The Caribbean, if you go to a meeting, any meeting that is held in the Caribbean, Beverly, you will be hard-pressed to get a group of people who are better than us at articulating and analyzing a problem. We are very eloquent when it comes to telling you what the problem is, analyzing every single facet of that problem. The problem is that in a year's time, and 2 years' time, and 3 years' time, we're doing the same thing. We have not advanced the agenda. So we're very good at analyzing and articulating the problem. We're horrible at implementation, and sometimes just simple implementation. It's as if there's a perverse delight we take in sounding so learned and so knowledgeable on a subject. But really, to me, where we should be focusing is in dealing with some of these problems that do not take a lot to address. And if there's anything I would like to see coming out of this post-COVID period, is a commitment to action in our region. We know the problems. We've analyzed some of the problems to death. We have reports ad infinitum on the state of food insecurity in the region, the state of energy insecurity, the state of water insecurity, the state of nutritional insecurity. Let us do something about it. And that's where regionalism and regional integration, but even more importantly, regional action. So going back to what Dr. Braffitt spoke about with reconfiguring and renaming the Ministry of Agriculture to the Ministry of Food Security, I think now we need to refocus our agendas on action. Maybe too much we by calling something a particular name, we believe that our role is to analyze and see, but no, we need to be action oriented. And we are not with the, again, I like what I see coming out of Barbados, and I really must compliment Prime Minister Mia Mottley for the approach that she's taken. I think she really is a breath of fresh air in our region. I would like to see that sort of vigor, that sort of very comprehensive approach to dealing with the problems. I would like to see that replicated, not just in governments, but within the institutions in our region that have been set up to address these problems. Our youth are important. Our youth are the ones that will give us the energy, the impetus. They don't have the cynicism. They want to see something happen, but they're impatient with the act, with the talk. And so that's where the two we need to marry. We need to marry the vigor and the impatience of the youth with the need for action.
Thank you, Dr. Fletcher. Dr. Braffitt, we have had, I would say, an amazing panel discussion, which provided really great insights on our topic, the post-COVID-19 scenario from the perspective of the Caribbean region. I mean, this was quite a very enriching discussion this morning. I mean, we have looked at several issues, some of the systemic issues. We've also looked at the need for the interlinkages for food security, the whole question of research and development, the situation relating to our debt swap for climate change, the use of our local resources or regional resources, that is, the whole issue of reframing, reshaping, refocusing the agricultural sector, a whole paradigm shift, whereby we really look at perhaps even some of the names that we have been utilizing over the years, renaming the agricultural sector, the ministry or the minister, as the case may be. The need for more action-oriented approaches and strategies. The need for commitment, and I dare say political will. Stronger leadership in all spheres. The need for ensuring that we do have the requisite legislation. And the whole question of how we perhaps look at the whole agricultural sector in terms of being part of the growth sector of our economies and the essentiality of the sector. As Dr. Braffitt said, it's synonymous to our national security and the need for perhaps looking at a regional food security fund or something to that effect. And the call for and engaging with our international agencies and some of our regional financial institutions with respect to redefining perhaps more palatable packages for supporting our agricultural sector or for supporting our growth in the region as it relates to financing some of our development initiatives. The whole question of regionalization or regionalism, perhaps looking at it from different lens. Earlier this week, or earlier in our discussions, we've had persons talking about perhaps a whole reconstruction of multilateralism, where it comes from the ground up, as opposed to the top-down approach. And I think our people has understood. You have certainly demonstrated your understanding of what is required. And we've spoken about perhaps, you know, what has been said since 1975. This seminar series certainly will not be one that will be a repeat of something that we will hear 10 years afterwards, because we know that we will use every opportunity to share this and trust and make every effort as part of our advocacy role as ICA to ensure that we do get this message to the relevant people and put it in all the spheres so that we can really see the much needed change that is required. I know that there's so much more to say, and I know there's a lot more that has been said that I perhaps didn't capture because I was trying to write, but at the same time with the excitement, I couldn't capture everything, but it was really a very, very enriching discussion this morning. So I would really want to invite you, our panelists, and perhaps our viewers as we continue with this series, to continue with this dialogue via our various virtual mediums and platforms. I will not let you go just yet because I think I will ask each of you to take 1 minute to say one final word before we wrap up. And before I do that, because I mean, you must want to say one compelling thing that perhaps you have not said before. I want to really extend a special thanks to our Director General, Dr. Manuel Otero, for the leadership, the vision, and the wisdom in convening these virtual sessions. They are really, really a great opportunity or part of the response that we think is necessary, whereby we listen to the views and to the views and perspective of persons who are on the ground, persons with the understanding, and as Jimmy and Dr. Bruffett has said, persons who know, persons who have the experience, so that these sessions are really rich and they provide tangible results or tangible solutions to what it is we are trying to do going forward. I would also like to thank our online viewers for participating in this important event. And last but not least, I would want to thank our panelists, our dear friends and close associates, Dr. Fletcher and Jimmy, for the richness of your ideas, which will certainly add to the body of knowledge on the topic of food security in Latin America and the Caribbean region post-COVID-19. So as I said, before I go, I will give each of you a minute or maybe a little more just to say one more compelling thing to our various listeners and viewers on this interesting topic today. Thank you.
If I may. May I?
Yes, Dr. Bruffett.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, I just want to thank you very much for your moderating of this important initiative today and your useful guidance and insights as we proceeded to give our opinions, and to thank you for your role. As a final comment, I would like to use this opportunity, if I may, to send a very humble message to our leaders that our independence as independent states in the world is challenged by our inability to feed ourselves. You cannot profess to be independent when somebody else feeds you. because that other entity, government, that feeds you is in a controlling position to control your destiny. Control what you eat. Control prices in your market. And ultimately, to control you. Therefore, independence must be understood, in my view, in a different context. And one important element of independence, if you say you're independent, you should be able to feed yourself. Maybe not get all the food that you need, but more than 10%. And if you're importing 90% of your food from a particular source, have no doubt that source can control you. I say no more.
Dr. Raffit. Jimmy? Could you just please unmute your mic? Jimmy?
Hear me?
Yes, now.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I said I'm tempted after that to say no more myself because I think Dr. Braffett has said everything that needs to be said. But as I said in the beginning, we are at an inflection point in the history of the development of our Caribbean. And as with all inflection points, we have it's either that we continue, we change our trajectory, or we go back to where we were, which is a business as usual case. We've seen that business as usual is not working for us in the Caribbean. Business as usual has been exposed by COVID-19 to be a very vulnerable, food insecure, energy insecure, water insecure, crime insecure environment that is not good for us. Every single measure of vulnerability, all of these vulnerability indices that you've seen put out, they show the Caribbean to be among the most vulnerable states in the world. We have an opportunity to do something about this. Nobody ever thought that they would see in their lifetime the entire planet coming to a standstill. This is what has happened. The entire planet has come to a standstill, and one little virus, something that's not even living, has brought the entire world to a standstill. We have an opportunity now to reset and to change our trajectory. We've seen our development has been pressure tested by this virus, and we have been found wanting. We now see all of the vulnerabilities. We see all of the leaks in that pipeline where water is gushing out. We have an opportunity to change. And you know, it's not just the things we've spoken about here. I'm sure if you have another panel that looks at energy, that looks at that nutrition, that looks at crime, that looks at the participation of women, you will find the same things being echoed. If we continue along the path that we on, then this, what has happened to us with COVID, it will not take much to knock us out. We have a hurricane season that's approaching us. This hurricane season has been predicted to contain more than average, it's supposed to be a more than average intensity hurricane season. Hurricanes have brought our respective countries to their knees. 365% of Jamaica's GDP being destroyed by Hurricane Gilbert, 226% of Dominica's GDP being destroyed by Hurricane Maria. So as bad as it is now, it can even get worse, and I shudder to think about that. So we have to develop resilience. We have to change the way in which we do things. And we do not change the way in which we do things by going back to the same thing with opening our tourism sector to the same type of tourism that we had before. As Dr. Braffett very eloquently said, allowing somebody else to feed you. He's right. When we establish independence from our parents is when we leave home, when we now are at our own homes and we are now responsible for feeding ourselves, even if occasionally we run back to our parents' home for a meal every now and again, but that's when we're independent. So you cannot be independent if you are depending on somebody else to feed you, and he could not have put it any better. So this is an opportunity for us to show that together we can be stronger, but together we can be independent. Together we can finally show that we one day will graduate from being countries that every year go cap in hand to the developed world, crying special and differential status. And we have, yeah, we'll always be a region that requires special and differential status. But at some point we should be a region that can help somebody else out. And I think if we don't put that as our goal, that we want to be, we want to graduate, not graduate the way the World Bank says we're graduating by GDP per capita, which is an absurd metric of economic progress, but graduating to the point where we've improve economic output, we've reduced inequalities, we've reduced our vulnerabilities, we have fewer people who are now dependent, and we have a robust natural environment that can continue to sustain life in all its forms, then that's when we can clearly say that we're independent. And this crisis has given us an opportunity to do that. And I just desperately hope that that opportunity is seized so that the Caribbean that we see developing, if next year AICA wants to have a follow-up to this with different panelists, they can say that was the watershed. 2020 was the watershed when we finally decided to get things right in our region.
Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you, our panelists. 2020 is perfect vision. So we trust that all that has been said really is summed up in this thought that the opportunity is now. And we have a unique opportunity for defining and shaping transformative change, not just change, but changing the trajectory towards food security in the region in a unique way. Let us not lose this opportunity. And I am very, very optimistic that in going forward, this will probably be not just a watershed, but a defining period within which we are going to see change evident going forward. I remain optimistic. It has been said that the oneness of a region in times of crisis is stronger than the crisis in the region. And I want us to believe that with all our hearts, because I believe the Caribbean, given our history, given the potential, and given maybe some of the systemic issues that we are facing, we also have what it takes to put this right, to press the reset button, and to ensure that we put ourselves back on a path of sustainability, of resilience going forward. I want to thank you again and to wish you all the best in the future. Remain safe, remain connected, and certainly you will hear from us in the very near future. Thank you very much.